What are genes? And how is engineering plant genes different from changing them with breeding? Well, these are both great questions, and to give you a great answer, I've been pondering the best analogy I could use to explain genetic engineering. It's at this point that I'll inform you, my name is Nick Syke, and I'm an addict. A Lego addict. This is the room in my house I've dedicated to my vice, and let me answer the next inevitable question that comes up. Yes, I have a wife. Yes, she lets this happen. Naturally, I'm inclined to use Lego to describe genetic engineering. You may have even heard of DNA described as the building blocks of life, and that's true, but today, I'm not using Lego as a stand-in for DNA. Instead, we're going to think of these two different Lego models I've built as organisms. We've got two different living things. They do have some blocks in common, in the same way that living things have proteins in common, but I've followed two different sets of instructions, resulting in two different organisms being created. In my analogy, these instruction booklets you get with Lego represent the DNA instructions you get in every cell of your body. So when your DNA instructions are followed like a Lego instruction booklet, you end up being the resulting Lego model that gets created. What's in the instruction booklet controls what's in the final model. This makes sense, right? I start with essentially a random pile of Lego proteins that could be any number of Lego model organisms, but the instruction booklets I'm following dictate which color and shape of piece goes where, which ends up informing the features and functions of the Lego model or organism I'm building. DNA works in exactly the same way as these booklets. It dictates how an organism is put together. It guides which assemblies and pieces go where, and which features and functions an organism is going to have when it's built. So how do I get features and functions from one Lego model to another? Well, I'd have to make a change to the DNA to the instruction booklet of the model, right? Well, how I modify that instruction booklet is analogous to how the genes of a plant would be modified. So, say I want the silver rims and this desk and this driver and this windshield combined with the features of this model over here. Well, in real life, when two organisms breed, their DNA gets combined. Maybe if I let these Lego models breed, I could get the features I want from each model into a single set of instructions. So I could close my eyes and take all of the pages from both instruction booklets and just randomly shuffle and combine them, and then build the model to check if we got a positive result. What I'm hoping for is the pages with the instructions for the features I like will end up in exactly the right place when I combine them with the other instruction booklet. It will for sure happen given enough attempts at shuffling, that's just math. Problem is, I might also get instructions where I didn't want them some of the time. The other problem here is that I can't know if I shuffled the instructions right until I actually build the model and see if it's correct. Breeding plants happens exactly this way. You have to breed many, many versions to get the one combination you're actually after, but you still won't know if you got exactly what you were looking for until planting. Because while I could technically check the Lego instructions to see if I got them assembled correctly in plant breeding, there is no way to check your work besides actually growing the plant. Traditional breeding takes a long time and gives plant breeders very little control over what is actually happening. This is why genetic engineering is actually a really helpful thing. Rather than shuffling pages together randomly and hoping the build goes well, genetic engineering can identify the page of the instruction booklet over here that has the instructions to build the feature I want. I can add a marker to it. I can also go over to this other set and mark the place in its instruction booklet where I need to insert the page from the other set, so that the features end up being built into the new model exactly where I want them to go. And even better, I can check to see if I got it right before I go ahead and build the model, and that saves me time. This idea of marking the parts of DNA you want to move around and checking the result is one major benefit we get with genetic engineering. So, once I've identified the feature I want in this instruction booklet, and once I've figured out where it goes in this instruction booklet, I can think about ways to get this information from here to here. This is equivalent to choosing the method of genetic engineering. Well, scissors will do a nicer job of cutting this page out than tearing would, and tape will help me fasten this page in the right place in its new booklet. And this is kind of how agrobacterium works. Agrobacterium is like nature's sneaky little DNA courier. They specialize in inserting DNA from their own genes into other organisms. Scientists just get in the middle of that natural process. They give the instructions they want moved around to the bacteria, and it naturally migrates the instructions to their new location and tapes them into their new booklet. This is as natural as breeding. Agrobacteria are natural. They do this instruction booklet editing thing naturally. In fact, sweet potatoes are naturally genetically engineered by agrobacteria. What you should take away from this is that how you choose to combine two sets of DNA instructions together is simply a matter of degrees. There are less involved, more time-consuming ways of shuffling DNA instruction booklets, like traditional breeding, for example. There are also more involved, less time-consuming ways of shuffling DNA, agrobacterium, for example. The point is, when it comes to DNA instruction booklets that make our food, we understand that making tweaks to those instructions is okay. I mean, we all get that breeding is part of farming, right? It's okay to randomly shuffle potentially dozens of pages of DNA around in breeding, but it's not okay to use scissors and tape to make a single page shuffle quickly, cleanly, and accurately. Well, a big factor here is that what I have done to these instruction booklets is considered by many Lego fans to be a form of sacrilege. I've damaged the instructions on purpose. Many Lego purists, myself included, recognize that there is a certain level of sanctity when it comes to Lego and the sets and the instructions you get. Using this analogy, I think many of us are under the impression that genetic engineering is more equivalent to mixing Mega Blocks and Lego and committing blasphemy against Lego on the highest order. That's not how genetic engineering works, though. DNA is just like Lego. It's a closed building system. It comes with a finite amount of parts that you can combine in an infinite amount of ways. And that's the beauty of the system. Yes, we know instructions that come with Lego from Lego are something special, and it's something to be respected, but if all a person is doing with Lego is following the instructions, well, you aren't getting the full experience. You aren't using the building system as Lego intended if you aren't improvising with it. The Lego gods want us to go beyond their instructions. Lego is equally good for following predetermined instructions as it is for following your own instructions too, so long as you never, ever use Mega Blocks. Just don't do it. So remember, all genetic engineering is putting features from one Lego model into another Lego model while trying to have the least amount of impact on the instruction booklets as possible. Perfectly acceptable. Again, genetic engineering does not mean you're sullying the sterling reputation of DNA by adding wannabe DNA to it. Genetic engineering does not mean mixing Lego and Mega Blocks, because that would be unnatural. Thanks for listening. Play well.